I'm gonna say he's gonna get.
I gotta wait for the slides to show up. I'm waiting on the slides to start.
All right, guys, how y'all doing this morning? All right, everybody stand up. Let love explode and bring the dead to life. A love so bold to see a revolution somehow. Let love explode and bring the dead to life. A love so bold to bring a revolution somehow. Now I'm lost in your freedom. In this world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Let hope arise and make the darkness hide. My faith is dead, I need a resurrection somehow. Let hope arise and make the darkness high. My faith is dead, I need a resurrection somehow. Now I'm lost in your freedom. In this world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. Heaven roll, and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roll, and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar, fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. There is power, power here in this hour, this hour. We're all together, together, waiting here as one. Whoa, 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 hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, 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 a mighty rushing wind. Whoa, whoa, whoa. We're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. Burning in my soul. All your sons and your daughters dreaming the dreams of the Father, seeing the signs and the wonders, the kingdom of God. Whoa, 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 hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, 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 a mighty rushing wind. Whoa, 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 we're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. Burning in my soul. And I cannot contain it. Fire inside, and I cannot contain it, so let it shine. And I cannot contain it, this light of mine. It's burning in my soul. Hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, whoa, whoa. A mighty rushing wind. Whoa, whoa, whoa. We're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. Burning in my soul. In my soul. In my soul. There is power, power. Here in this hour, this hour. We're all together, together, waiting here as one. Whoa, 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 hear the sound from heaven. Whoa, 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 a mighty rushing wind. Whoa, 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 we're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul. In my soul. In my soul. In my soul.
All right, y'all can be seated.
Would you pray with me? God, thank you so much that we serve a God who's not dead,
We look forward to seeing what you're going to do here today, and we wait expectantly to hear what you're going to say to us through my friend Luke. We also pray for mercy for Miss Ware's grandfather and for wisdom for the doctors who are caring for him. I pray that you would help us to live a life of love by your Spirit. It's in your name we pray, God. Amen. Guys, I'm happy to introduce you to my friend Luke. Would you give him a warm welcome, please?
Do I need this? Do I need this? No, I not need this. Y'all hear me? Okay. Hey, I'm Luke Sadler. I work for an organization called Young Life, and Young Life is a ministry that tries to introduce people to Jesus and help them grow in their faith, and we really try to do that with people who either don't know anything about them or maybe people who have some misconceptions about them, and we try to help them work them out with those because I really believe the most compelling person to ever walk the earth by far is Jesus, and what a great opportunity we have in our life to know God. And maybe if you are anything like me when you're in high school right now, I really knew a lot about Jesus, I at least thought I did, and I thought there were some hoops that I had to jump through to be a Christian, but whenever anybody asked me as I got older what it looked like to have a relationship with Jesus, I really couldn't put that into words. I didn't really know anything about that. That was kind of a foreign concept to me. And so this morning, I really am just hoping to encourage you. If you do know Jesus and have a relationship with him, I hope if you're feeling in a burden season, this will be an encouragement to you. And if you were like me when I was in high school and you kind of think that you know him, but maybe you don't, then hopefully this will also be an encouragement to you as well. I think before anyone's going to listen to anything I have to say about Jesus, you probably want to know a little bit about me. At least that's how I am with people. And I feel like the only way you can really know something about someone is if they tell you their most embarrassing moment. So allow me to share with you the dumbest thing I have ever done in my life. I was a freshman in college. I drove a 1992 Toyota Camry 5-speed manual transmission. That's a stick shift. Who here was born after 1992? Everybody. A little part of me just died inside. All right. And who here either drives a stick shift or their parents drive a stick shift? All right. That little part of me just came back to life. Here we go. That's good. So I'm driving this Camry, and it all started in a gravel parking lot. Me and the Toyota Camry. Who here likes action movies? Anybody? Yes. If you like action movies, if you watch action movies, without a shadow of a doubt, you have seen a reverse 180. What a reverse 180 is when you are going in reverse, full speed, and at the precise moment, you slam in the clutch, cut the wheel, pull the emergency brake, the car spins around, you then shift it into first or second gear, depending on how fast you're going, and then slam on the gas, the wheels white smoke, and then some dude sticks his head out the window waving an American flag, dumping sweet tea over his head, going, "Woo, America, back-to-back World War champions!" All right, I got a little carried away there, but I just want you to feel the feeling that I feel every time I do a reverse 180. So that just is a little picture, a little capture of what that is like. And so here we go. As we're rolling in, me and my friends, I take them out to the lot. I show them my skills. I practice doing the reverse 180 a few times till I am a self-proclaimed expert at the reverse 180. And so I pledged a fraternity my freshman year of college. Like a lot of people do. And the thing about being a pledge is I had to prove to the members of the fraternity that I was awesome so that they would let me in. And I thought, what better way to do that than a reverse 180, you know? So we finished on a Thursday night our alcohol awareness seminar, which is kind of funny. And then we were walking outside. The whole fraternity steps outside. And I thought, this is it. This is my time to shine. And so I got in my car. I got my friends who have seen my expertise at the reverse 180 to block both ends of the road so that way I would have it to myself. This environment was a little different than the one I practiced in. I was usually in an empty gravel parking lot, and this one was a kind of a narrow street with parked cars on both sides. But I just thought, I'm that good. I've got this. My confidence greatly outweighed my stupidity at that moment. And so I got in there, and I said these famous last words out my window. Hey, guys, watch this. Slammed it in reverse, got going probably about 50 miles an hour before I cut the wheel, slammed the emergency brake, and before I could shift it into first gear, bang! I was parked inside the back of a Toyota Tercel. It was by far the most humbling experience, and I was quickly trying to think of something to say to recover this moment because I knew all eyes were on me, and so I just said out the window, bet you guys didn't see that coming. Well, you know, a police report and $400 later, that I still have the story. It lives on. I don't think I've done another reverse 180 since then, but I need to. Maybe I will in the parking lot before I leave. But so here is the thing is, you know, reverse 180s, they really should be left to the professionals. And maybe you think following Jesus is something that should be left to the professionals, like your pastor, your youth pastor, maybe some of your teachers, like they're professional Jesus followers. They got this thing figured out. Like when I get to be Mr. Cole's age, then I can follow Jesus. I'll know everything I ever need to know about him. And that was a little bit of what was going on in me when I was in high school for sure. And so really I want to talk about somebody who really reminds me of myself. And that's Peter. Peter is just like me because when I was in high school and even in college and even this week, I just really blew it sometimes, you know, just really, really messed up, made big, big mistakes. I mean, that reverse 180 is just the tip of the iceberg. And I just, you know, kept thinking with all these screw-ups I have in my life, there's no way at all Jesus would want to have anything to do with me. You know, there's no way I would ever measure up for him. And so I really love Peter because as I look at the way Jesus interacts with Peter, that gives me a great picture, I think, of how he interacts with me. And so the first time we see Peter interacting with Jesus, he is in a boat. He's been fishing all night. He hasn't caught anything. And Jesus wants to get in his boat and venture out a little from the shore so he can teach this big crowd of people that's come to see him. So I'm sure Peter is like, who is this guy that wants to use my boat? I'm really tired, and where did all these people come from? And then he gets this awesome front row seat to Jesus talking to this crowd about whatever he was talking about. I don't know. I don't know what he was talking about. It doesn't tell me. But I imagine it was pretty spectacular because whenever Jesus gets done talking, he says to Peter, let's head out to deeper waters and put down your nets for a catch. And I don't know if you know anything about fishing. I certainly don't. But what little I do know is that deep water back then was not where you caught fish. I mean, they were mostly fishing with nets. They weren't doing any deep sea fishing, and so you wanted to be in the shallow water where you could see the fish and throw the net on them and then pull them in. And so here, a carpenter is telling these expert fishermen, hey, let's go out to deep water and try to catch some fish. And, you know, Simon Peter, he's trying to be polite. He's saying, hey, you know, we fished all night in the place we're supposed to fish, and we still did not catch anything. But lo and behold, they must have heard something that Jesus said or the way he was saying it that had kind of earned the right to do what he asked. And they said, but at your word, we'll let down the nets. And so they head out there to deeper water, and they let down the nets, and boom, you know, they pull in too many fish for one boat. They have to bring the other boat over to get the fish in. And what is Simon Peter's reaction? He says this right here. He says, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. You know, fell down at Jesus' knees saying that. You know, it must have been something that Jesus had said or maybe what Jesus had just done, but Simon could tell that Jesus was pretty close to, if not God, and he knew he wasn't. He was probably the exact opposite. He was a pretty rough mouth, foul-tempered fisherman. And I relate to that a lot because I know a lot of times I don't feel like I'm good enough for God, and that's because I'm not, and neither was Peter. But, you know, Jesus does something really cool here. He doesn't say to Peter, yeah, you're right, you know, clean up your act, you know, get memorize some Bible verses, and then come back to me, and we can talk. Instead, he does something pretty incredible. He says, do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men. Do not be afraid. You're going to be catching men. What a beautiful moment where Jesus is identifying right where Peter's at. I know you're afraid. I know you think I don't like you, but I actually like you a whole lot. So much that I want you to follow me, live life with me, and I'm going to show you some cool things along the way. And that's what I need to hear. That's what I need to know. And I hope you hear that too, that if you're feeling like you're in a real season of life or anything, that you are just blowing it and that Jesus wouldn't want to have anything to do with you, this is what he's saying to you. Don't be afraid. Don't worry about it. Just come. Come with me. Live life with me. And so 3 years later, they are living life together and, best friends, the three best friends anyone could have. And, you know, they are just, life is good. And then that Last Supper together comes along, and Jesus kind of tries to prepare them as best that he can for what's about to happen in the next couple days. And he says to them, you will all fall away because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I'm raised, I'll go before you to Galilee. And Peter, oh man, Peter. Yes, I am with you, Peter. Though they all fall away because of you, I will never fall away. So confident. Like, that is me in that car. Peter is riding shotgun with me, doing that reverse 180. Like, we got this. We got this. Come on. And Jesus, so gently, so kindly, so confidently, says, truly I tell you, this very night, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. And Peter says, even if I got to die with you, I will not deny you. And we kind of know how that all plays out, that Jesus ends up getting arrested. Everybody runs, even Peter, even though he goes all medieval on Malchus's ear, you know, one last final swoop. But even after that, he takes off running and gets approached by this little servant girl. I mean, a little, come on, it's Peter. It is Peter. And you're letting this little girl punk you out, like, right in front of all your friends. Like, that's crazy. But he does exactly what Jesus says. He says, you were with Jesus the Galilean. And he says, I do not know what you mean. And then another said, this man was with Jesus of Nazareth. And he says, I don't know the man. And finally, somebody can pick it up in his accent and in his voice. He says, certainly you too are one of them, for your accent betrays you. And he began to invoke a curse on himself and to swear, I do not know the man. And immediately the rooster crowed, and he remembered what Jesus said, and he went out and wept bitterly. Man, yeah, I relate to that right there. That resonates with me, because there's been multiple times in my life where I just thought, that's it. I crossed the bridge. This is it. I did the one thing I'm not supposed to do when I'm following Jesus. I'm screwed. It's over. Jesus is done with me. Like, you would think, denying Jesus 3 times, that's it. Like, that is the, like, worst possible thing you could do. Like, that's the end. That's going to sever every tie Peter has with Jesus. And then he dies, and then he's, you know, they're scared and hiding in a room. And finally, we see after a few days, Peter's just fed up. He's like, guys, I'm going fishing. You know, I don't know what else to do. I know I haven't gone fishing in 3 years. The last time I was fishing, I was with Jesus, but I don't know what else to do. I'm just going to go back and go fishing. And the other folks, the other disciples say, hey, we'll go with you. And that's, oh, man, I get that too. You know, sometimes when I hit the end of my rope, when I feel like I got nothing left, I just go back to doing what I did before I started following Jesus, because it seems easier. It seems like that's got to be the way to life. But ultimately, all those things, whatever I was putting my hope in, whether it was making that team or getting into that college or having that job or getting this girl to like me, all those things really just ended up coming up short. And fishing's right there with it. And so, again, they go out, and guess what? They don't catch a thing. These guys were terrible fishermen. Like, they needed it was a good thing Jesus came along, because they weren't going to last very long. They were not good at catching fish. But then the risen Jesus shows up on the shore and says, children, do you have any fish? And they remembered, and they answered him, no. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. Which is so crazy, because if you know anything about these boats, they were like this narrow. Like, they were just wide enough for you to sit in. And it was like, all right, I've been fishing over here all night and you're saying the fish are right here? Like, you got to be kidding me, right? But they did it. And it says that they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. And John, one of Jesus' friends, said to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard it, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The first time Peter is in a boat and realizes who Jesus is, he hits his knees and says, depart from me, Lord, I'm a sinful man. The next time he's fishing in a boat, realizes it's Jesus, after this huge screw-up, after he's completely blown it, he dives in head first. Dives in head first. He gets on the shore, and Jesus invites them to have breakfast together. So cool. And then he walks with Peter, pulls him away from the rest of the group, and asks him three times if he loves him. And Peter says yes each time. What a great, that's so good. Like, right after this huge screw-up, Jesus gives him three chances to kind of reaffirm what he already knew. And finally, he gives him the last word right there in verse 19. After saying this, he said to him, follow me. So what he said to him the first time, do not be afraid, follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. He's saying to him at the end, follow me. Just keep following me. And so I don't know where you're at right now, but if you feel like you're just too screwed up, that God doesn't want to have anything to do with you right now, that you got to clean your act up, I want to say, hold on. And let's look at Peter. And the only thing we got to do is dive in, head first into the love of Christ. It's deeper and wider and higher and richer than we'll ever know. And Jesus is big enough to take all our screw-ups and cover them up. And he did that by dying on a cross for you and for me. And while he was hanging there, the last thing he said is, it is finished. And so when you're at your lowest of low, when you have slammed into that Toyota Tercel in your life, and you and Peter are looking at each other like, that's it, it's over, we're screwed, I want you to know that Jesus is sitting in the back seat, reaching up, tapping you on the shoulder, saying, it's okay, I got this. I love you. Now get out of the car and follow me. My time is up. Let me pray for us. Lord, thanks so much for doing that for us, for loving us enough to invite us in, to make a way so that we could be with you, to show us it's not about us being good enough and reaching up to you, but it's about us accepting the gift that you give to us in grace and love and sacrifice. So I pray that now and forevermore, even when we just completely mess up, that we would still get up and follow you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Savior, I come and quiet my soul. Remember Redemption's hill where your blood was spilled. My ransom and everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong. Tempted and tried, human, word became flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen, and everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you, Lord. I lay me down, rid me of
sounded so good.
Good job.
Good job, guys.